Section 2.1, organizing qualitative data. The objectives of Section 2.1 is we're going to organize qualitative data in tables, construct bar graphs, and construct pie charts. Chapter 1 discussed how to identify the research objective and collect data. We learned that data can be obtained from either observational studies or design experiments. When data are obtained, they are referred to as raw data. The purpose of this chapter is to learn how to organize raw data into a meaningful form so we can understand what the data are telling us. The first step in determining how to organize raw data is to determine whether the data is qualitative or quantitative. Okay, so first thing is first, we want to look at objective one, organizing qualitative data in tables. Now, when qualitative data are collected, we often first determine the number of occurrences within each category. A frequency distribution lists each category of data and the number of occurrences for each category of data. In any frequency distribution, it is a good idea to add up the frequency column. The total will be equal to the number of observations. Now, for this example, we want to be able to organize qualitative data into a frequency distribution. The example states that a physical therapist wants to determine types of rehabilitation required by her patients. To do so, she obtains a simple random sample of 30 of her patients and records the body part requiring rehabilitation, which you can see here. This is the table below. Now we're going to construct a frequency distribution of location of injury. So in order to construct a frequency distribution, we're going to create a list of the body parts, which are the categories. So here's the body part, and we got to list each individual body part that's in here. So we have back, we have wrist, elbow, hip, shoulder, knee, hand, groin, and neck. And then we're going to tally each occurrence. Now once we tally each occurrence, then we're going to add up the number of tallies or the observations to determine the frequency. So let's start with the first body part that we have here, which is back. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Again, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. So we have another 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. And then we have 1 and then 2. So when we add up those observations together, we're going to get a frequency number of 12. Next, we want to find the wrist. So here's 1, and then there's another one here's 2. So we have 2 for the wrist. Now for the elbow, let's take a look at the elbow. If we go down, there's 1, and there's no other one, so we're going to tally there, and that means we have 1. And then for the hip, we have 1, and then 2. So we have 2, and then for the shoulder, we have 1, 2, 3, and then 4. And then we have the knee. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. And then for the hand, we have 1 and then 2. And then for the groin, we have 1. And then for the neck, we have 1. Okay. And so now, once we have all the frequencies, now we know what the frequencies are. Now, what is the total of the frequencies? Meaning if we add up all these numbers together. So if we add up all these numbers together, that means we're going to get a total of 30. Okay, so what that says is in any frequency distribution, it is a good idea to add up the frequency column to make sure that it equals the number of observations in this example. So in example one, the frequency column totals to 30 as it should because there are 30 body parts, meaning the observation. Okay, next. Okay, often we want to know the relative frequency of the categories rather than just the frequency. The relative frequency is the proportion or percent of observations within a category and is found by using this following formula. To get the relative frequency, it's going to equal the number of observations of that frequency divided by the sum of all the frequencies. Now, a relative frequency distribution lists each category of data together with the relative frequency. So when working with a relative frequency distribution, the total of the relative frequencies should be equal to 1 because it represents 100% of the data. So let's go ahead and take a look at an example here. Okay, so we're going to use the same information that we had from the previous example. And so what we're going to do is we're going to construct a relative frequency distribution of qualitative data. So using the summarized data in the previous example, we're going to construct a relative frequency distribution. Okay, how do we approach this? Now, we know that the sum of all the values in the frequency column in the table is 30. So what we mean by that is that when we add up the total frequency, we get the total of 30, which is important for us. Okay, so we know the sum of the frequencies is 30. Okay, now what we want to do is now we want to compute the relative frequency of each category. So for example, we're going to take the relative frequency of the category back. So we know that there is a number of 12 as the frequency, and we're going to divide it by the total, which is 30. So if we take 12 and divide that by 30, let's go ahead and do that on our calculator, 12 divided by 30, and that gives us 0.4. And we'll write that in two decimal places, 0.40. Okay, now the relative frequencies are shown in the column here, 3, of this table. So from the distribution, the most common body part for the rehabilitation is the back, because you can see that this number is larger than any other number. So let's go ahead and continue. So we're going to take 2, and then we're going to divide that by 30. And then that's going to give us approximately to 4 decimal places, 0.0667. Okay, if we move into then 1 over 30, okay, this is going to give us a decimal to 4 decimal places, 0.0333. Okay, if we take 2 and then divide that by 30, we already know from the previous example it's 0.0667. Okay, and then if we take 4 and then divide that by 30, then that's going to give us 0.1333. If we take 5 and then divide that by 30, then we're going to get the value of 0.1667. Again, if we take 2 and then divide that by 30 from our previous ones, we got 0.0667. And if we take 1, divide that by 30, gives us 0.0333. And if we take 1 and then divide that by 30, and that also gives us approximately 0.0333. Okay, so therefore, there are our total, our relative frequency. Now, let's go ahead and add these up and see what happens. So if we add these up, we take 0.4 plus 0.0667 plus 0.0333 plus 0.0667 plus 0.1333 plus 0.1667 plus 0.0667 plus 0.0333 plus 0.0333. Okay, that gives us a total of 1. Okay, so therefore there is our total of 1. Now what we could also do is we can rewrite this in terms of decimal equivalency. So if we wanted to round this to two decimal places, then we would say, okay, well, this is 0.40. This would be 0.07. This would be 0.03. 0.07. 0.13. 0.17. 0.07. 0.03, and then 0.03, okay? And then again, this represents 100% of the data. So if we want to convert this to a percent, then we would just multiply each value by the percent, meaning 100%. So if we multiply this number by 100%, then we would get 40%, okay? And then multiplying this by 100% would then give us 7%. And then so on, 3%, 7%, 13%, 17%, 7%, 3%, and then 3%. So again, we can see that 40%, again, represents the what? The most common body part for the rehabilitation, which is the back. Okay, so it is a good idea to add up the relative frequencies to be sure they sum up to 1. Now, in fraction form, the sum should be exactly 1. Meaning when you add up all these fractions, 12 plus 2 plus 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 5 plus 30 plus 2 plus 1 plus 1, that's going to be 30 over 30. Okay, and then in decimal form, okay, the sum may differ slightly from 1 due to rounding, but in this example, we end up getting 1. Okay, now that we've done this by hand, which is important to understand how to do this by hand, now we're going to go ahead and see how do we do this by using StatCrunch. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to open up StatCrunch, and then what we've done is we're going to put in the entire table, so the information that we have in this table, we would then list into the first column. So as you can see here, here is our first column. We're putting all that information in here. Now, once you put in, you title the column, it says data, and then below that, you put all your information in. And once you do that, you're going to come over here and select stats. And then when you go to stats, you're going to go down to where it says table. And then next to table, you're going to see frequency. So now if you select frequency, okay, and you're going to select data, so you want to make sure you click on it so then it's moved over here. And then what we want is we want the frequency table. So let's go ahead and find out what that is first. So we're going to go ahead and select compute, and then you can see our frequency distribution. So we have our qualitative data, and then it numbered up the frequency distribution, which we got 12, you know, elbow 1, and so on. So therefore, it put that all information in for us, and here it listed everything alphabetically. Okay, so there is the frequency distribution. So this is something important that when you would do your project at some point in a semester. Okay, next, now we want to do is we want to find the relative frequency distribution. So we're going to again do the same thing. We're going to stat, we're going to scroll down to tables, and then we're going to select frequency. We're going to select data again, and then down here, we're going to highlight the option for relative frequency. Okay, so now we're going to go ahead and select compute, and then here, you're going to see the same values. Where they're not rounding it to four decimal places, but it gives us the same information that we got for our relative frequency distribution.